So I've been watching this show that everyone's been raving about all summer, I feel like. It's called Manifest. If you have, yes, Benny's watching.
Oh, we are crushing it right now.
Oh, are you?
Oh, the girlfriend and I are deep into it. Seriously,
I'm just
can't
like,
get enough.
Yes. So it's so in it. Okay, so
what I love,
for those of you, go ahead.
Sorry, real quick. Sorry, I love that. It's just I didn't know how many people were actually watching this because I randomly put it on and Saba had already seen the whole thing. So I thought I was late, you know. But no, there's so many people that I'm finding out now that are watching it.
You're
kind
late,
of
girl.
I know. Stop. But still, there's a bunch of people who I'm finding that are also like just now getting hip to it, you know? Like,
yeah.
Okay, so go ahead. Take it away. So sorry.
So to that point, I'd actually started watching it back in May, June, sorry, when my cousin's wedding was happening.
Okay.
Her cousin was watching it just like as passing whenever we didn't have anything to do. And so like I sat down a couple times and I was like, what is this show and what is going on? Like, I feel like I've jumped in the middle of something and I need to go back to the beginning because like it's good, but I don't know what's happening.
Because you had a calling.
So, you know, I did.
I'm dead.
That
Stop.
Was my calling.
Stop.
Like, hey, that was good. And then somebody else was like, have you seen Manifest? And I was like, you know, I did start that and it looked good. And then somebody else was like, have you seen Manifest? And I was like, that must have been my calling back in June.
That is
the show was the show was manifesting itself into your life.
So basically, like, I had decided back in June that I was gonna, you know, revisit it, but I've had a lot of other things that I've been trying to watch. You know, Handmaid's Tale, I had to finish that.
Yeah.
A Black Lady sketch show, had to finish that. And I was like, as soon as I finish those, Manifest, it's on and popping. I started it on Thursday. I got through season two by like Sunday and I'm on season three. I'm midway through season three. Here's the thing about the show. Each episode's like 40 minutes long. I don't know how I'm doing it. Like every time I'm like, oh, I'll probably only watch an episode or two. And then I'm like, dang, I finished the season? When did the next episode even come
It's
on?
Addicting.
Benny, where are you at in the series?
We're just finishing up one, rolling into two. So if I need to close my ears, I will.
I don't have very many spoilers.
That's okay.
What I will say is, so it is on NBC for those who have cable. It's on, for the season one and two are on Netflix. Mm-hmm. If you're rolling through seasons one and two, you can watch it, the third season on Hulu. You can also watch it on Amazon Prime, but you have to pay for it. So that just doesn't even make sense. I am on IMDb. It has a 7.1 out of 10 score, which is pretty high compared to some of the other things I've reviewed. But it's still like a 70%. But I'm like, okay.
I think it should be higher.
Right. I was like, I wonder if Rotten Tomatoes does TV series.
It's a little like I can see, I guess maybe from where I'm at, I can see maybe why it doesn't have like the highest of ratings. But it's a great show to watch. It's an easy show to watch. Like I'm hooked.
Yeah.
I'm so hooked.
I think it's a little chunky that like it's not all the way smooth to become a higher rated show. I think it's very chunky and segmented. They could do a little bit better of a job maybe editing. That might be it, because there are moments or parts where I'm like, wait, and it's kind of jerky. So in my own little world,
get a little bit into it. Into it.
So one thing I will say is that it is, they have finished with season three. From my understanding, they had canceled it. But people are petitioning for season four, of course, because it's addicting. It's great. Everybody loves it. Fans, of course, have a theory that there will be more information on whether or not they plan to renew on 828 day, which
is that August 28th?
Yes, 828.
It's a Saturday. It's not on your show. Man.
Right? So for those of you guys who don't know, that is a reoccurring number and theme throughout the entire show. So hopefully something does come out August 28th on whether or not they're going to do a season four. I hope so, because where I'm at in season three, it doesn't feel like anything's really going to get resolved. The plot is only thickening. But I have two questions. Can Ben listen to anyone? So Ben is one of the main characters.
He's
and
rogue.
You guys, he literally is rogue and it's
always
annoying. He's always putting everybody in danger. And I'm like, he's like, I'm trying to save everyone. I'm like, by
he's like, I'm following the callings. We have to follow the callings.
Period. Yeah, nothing else.
Like, he is a roller coaster of emotions, you guys. Like, you think at some point he's gonna like kind of chill out and you're gonna like him
or sleep. No. He never sleeps. Yeah. He never sleeps.
I'm surprised that one of the episodes hasn't been him having a mental breakdown. Right. Because like legitimately don't know the guy's going through.
I feel like this is the mental break at this point. He's just in it. He's just in it.
And then I don't know if this is a spoiler. You said, what season are you on, Benny?
He just finished one.
Okay, so I need to know why Mick and Jared can't be together. That's all. Like, I stand there.
Girl, it's a roller coaster. It is a roller coaster.
I want that relationship. I don't want this other one. And I don't know why this other one even, like, came about. I know it has to do with the Collings and their connection, but I'm over it.
You can tell. There's no way that it's... Here's the thing. I'm not even where you're at in this season, in the show. And if they do renew for a season four, I can see this being a constant, like, boomerang. It's going to be a constant thing.
Like
it is.
Like the third Twilight movie. Will they, won't they? Will they, won't they? But all I want is for her to be with him. Like, it just makes sense. Why wouldn't she be?
They were together before.
And they were madly in love when she came back. So I just don't understand why. Yeah. Well, let's have a plot twist there. No, I shipped them, put them back together. I pray on the other relationship's downfall. And that's all I'm going to say. That's my review of Manifest. I would love it if everybody listening went and watched it and let me know what they think, because I've got a lot to say. And if you haven't watched it, let's talk.
I do want you guys to watch it as well. I'm not even where Shantae is, and I just finished season two last night. I saw Shantae tweet something about it, and I was like, girl, tell me why I'm watching it right now.
And she sent me, like, the episode she was on. I was like, ooh, you're on the season finale. Like, I already knew. I was like, it doesn't get better. It doesn't.
Yeah, it's rough. It's rough. So yeah, Benny, we'll be excited to see where, like, I want to see how far you get after we touch base.
Yeah, sounds again. Like a plan. Sure, yeah.
Okay, so let me get into my review of the week, y'all. I am obsessed with Leon Bridges' Gold Digger Sound album, you guys. I don't know, I might have mentioned something on this show briefly, like a few months ago, about this song Motorbike that I was obsessed with, but like it came up on some random playlist of mine, and I was like, oh, I like this song. Played that song out literally like 10 times in one day, and then I was like sharing it with everyone that would listen. I was like, this song you need to listen to, this song you need to listen to. So naturally, when Leon decided to drop the album, I was like, I'm gonna love this. Are you playing it?
Oh, yeah, because everyone needs to stop watching Manifest. Stop watching Manifest right now. You need to hear about Leon Bridges.
Yeah, see right there. It's just a whole vibe. And so I knew that if I like this song and the whole album drops, I was like, I'm gonna love it. He did not fail to disappoint. I didn't even know that it dropped. Just all of a sudden, and my phone was like, hey, recommended music for you. So I listened to it, and I was gonna tell you guys, here's a few of my favorite songs. Outside of Motorbike, I love Steam. He has another one called Why Don't You Touch Me, Magnolias, Details, and Don't Worry. Basically the entire album, I realized as I was like starting to list it, but it really is that good. And it's one of those kind of albums that you can definitely listen to through and through from beginning to end. You know, it all goes together. It all has a sound, and I feel like a purpose. Why Don't You Touch Me really is, for me, kind of reminiscent of like that older R&B sad stuff of like, this dude is really pouring his heart out in this song. You can tell that he's in a relationship, and I guess maybe they're in like a lull, or they're going through something, and he's not really feeling loved or desired by her. And and he's literally telling her, he's like, you know, I'm doing the most. He's like, I'm dressing up for you, you're still not yeah, like, I still don't have your attention. Like, you're still looking elsewhere. Like, yeah, it really was like, and you can hear it in his voice that he's like, if you tell, like, you say that we're in love, like, why are you not touching me? Like, I
maybe
felt that.
Physical touch isn't her love language. Dang.
Right. Suddenly
nice
that changed, pull.
Though. All about love languages. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, like, so that, I need to, and you said, Betty, did you say that there was a visual for that song?
There is a music video, and I did some digging this morning, and it's actually the actress from 13 Reasons Why, Alicia Bo, is that who? Yeah. She's in the video. And she nails it with the whole, exactly what you described on the relationship of in the video and for how the song is.
Oh, perfect. Really?
So, yeah, you need. That's what I was saying. You need to watch.
I'm so sad now. but you guys, I definitely recommend it. One other song that I wanted to mention before I touch on kind of like the sound of it is Sweeter. And Sweeter is definitely a song that's kind of fitting for the times. He's basically saying that, like, you know, you guys have stolen kind of like my innocence. You know, why am I taught to fear dark skin? Why am I taught, you know, these things? You guys have taken my innocence and hoping for a life that's more sweeter because of these things. And I really like it. It took me a few times to like listen to it before I actually, you know, I feel like got the meaning behind it, and I definitely like it, just kind of like hits differently. So definitely recommend it. But he has a very soulful jazzy vibe. There's lots of horns and whatnot, if that makes sense. You can't help but just like want to go for a ride and like watch the sunset or something like that, you know. And it's definitely got an old soul. He has an old soul, I feel like. Even if you watch his music videos, he looks like he's dressing from like, I feel like, the 60s or 70s, you know. He just from a whole different era. He's not from this time. But yeah, you guys, so definitely check it out. It's Leon Bridges' Gold Digger's Sound. I highly recommend the entire album. If you guys don't have time for that, at least check out Motorbike, Steam, and Why Don't You Touch Me, and Sweeter. Again, but the whole album. Just do the whole album. Just do the whole album.
I just downloaded it. I love the sound of horn. So
yeah.
Yeah. Well, and I remember last week when I was like falling in love with it, I was like, oh, you'll like this song. I was like, oh, you need to check out this song. So yeah. But revisit it, Tay, and definitely, like I said, try it from beginning to end. You should definitely do it from beginning to end.
I stumbled across him. He was featured on, I think, the first season of Big Little Lies. Is that what the TV show? And it was like played. Yeah.
His song the theme song?
River, yeah, or at least it's close to. It was used in it. I know that, and that's why.
No way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Here,
dude,
this
I'm
one?
So like.
Been traveling these wide roads for so long.
Right? No?
My heart's been
so good.
From you, 10,000.
What's that?
But I know this song.
Right?
River.
Oh, I want to come near and give you every part of me.
Yeah, his voice is so beautiful. It's so smooth. I love him so much. I've fallen in love with Leon. anyways, as I digress. All right.
I'm now looking him up because I'm like, do I know him from something else?
We might.
I swear I just know him, but he's not who I thought he was earlier when we were talking about it. At all.
Yeah, you said you thought he was somebody from Hairspray.
Yeah, that's Elijah Kelly.
Yep.
Oh.
Put it in the comments.
Okay.
Oops.
Yeah. Understood. Understood.
Yeah. He did this one.
Live from the funk, it's hotter than Texas. Right from the jump, yeah, you got my attention. Give me that stuff, and it's such
that's blessing. If it feels good. That's another good one.
No, I don't know it.
Oh,
man, yeah. Maybe I don't know who this is, but like, I feel like I know him.
You're gonna fall in love with him, so I guarantee you, after this album, you'll probably listen to his other stuff.
Well, thank you for putting us on.
Yeah, no props, guys. No problem. So
now that we've gone through our reviews of the week, definitely check out Manifest. Check out Gold Digger Sound by Leon Bridges. And let us know what you guys think, because we want to talk to people about it and we want to know what y'all think. But before we get into our hot topics for the day, we're going to jump into a 2 to 3 minute break. Stay tuned. You're listening to The Way with Jazz and Tay.
Welcome back to The Way with Jazz and Tay. Hey, it's your girl Jazz and Shantae. Before the break, you guys, we went ahead and gave our reviews of the week as well as our weekly recaps. If you guys are just now tuning in, Shantae gave a review of the show Manifest, which is on NBC. Netflix has both seasons 1 and 2. Hulu has seasons, I'm sure, just 3. And then Amazon Prime if you want to pay for it. But go ahead and check it out. All of us highly recommend it. And then I went ahead and gave my review of Leon Bridges' album, Gold Digger's Sound. Again, highly recommended. A lot of beautiful music on it. Now we're going to go ahead and jump into our hot topic, which is a bit of a roundup and all kind of erring on the side of mental health and mental health awareness. So, Shantae, do you want to go ahead and talk about the topic that you brought to the table?
Absolutely. So a couple of weeks ago, this is actually a bit of old news, but we felt like it was such a trending hot topic that we wanted to touch on it since we are huge mental health advocates. So we're sure by now you all know that the Olympics are currently going on. They started July 23rd and will go through Sunday, August 8th. Last week, there was a whirlwind of news around Simone Biles, a member of the USA gymnastics team. She decided to withdraw from the team event, stating that she was having mental health issues. And so she thought that it would be better for her team and for herself to go ahead and withdraw from the team event. Of course, the entire world, the entire US, had a ton of opinions about this. You know, many people were criticizing her and basically saying that she just wasn't able to hack it. She, you know, talked herself up and then just took the easy way out. And since then, I do want to note that she did return to do her individual category in balance beam, and she actually won the bronze. But we, again, just wanted to run it back to talk about this entire topic and conversation, because we actually, when it was happening, had a lot of conversation between ourselves about it. I personally think that what Simone did was extremely brave, and I think that for her own health and safety, it was a smart move. I think that hopefully we see more of this in the future.
Yeah.
Because yeah. Personally, as an athlete, if you're not mentally there, are you really even doing the team any good at all? I think that there's a lot to be said that, like, you know, you want to physically be at your best, but you also want to mentally and spiritually just all around be at your best so that you can perform your best. You can't have something be lagging and expect to perform at your top level. Because let's be real, if Simone had gone through with performing and she didn't do well, guess what people were going to do? Criticize her for not doing well. So it's like, regardless of what she had done in that moment, people were going to criticize her. So she at least got the ridicule for taking care of herself. You know, I don't think that anything is worth your safety and your health. And if that's what you need to do for yourself, who cares what anybody else thinks? And I think that's what she did. Jazz, what are your thoughts?
I am 100% right there with you. You so often, and just even outside of the Olympics, in like injuries, you know, physicality and all that kind of stuff, mental health is not necessarily talked about as a reason why someone might not necessarily be able to perform. You know, it's expected that, well, you need to be able to perform regardless of what's going on outside, because physically you are able and you are capable, and that's just what has been expected for years. And in any sport, it doesn't matter what event or whatever you do, it's just, well, if you can physically do it, why aren't you?
Yeah,
like, suck it up, put it to the side, like, yeah. And it's ingrained in us that it's like, yeah, well, I'm taught to put, like, it's teaching us something, you know, like, well, this is right. part of life, you know, this is what you have.
Building character.
There you go. That's, yeah. Yeah. And, and no, you can build character in a lot of other ways, in healthier ways. but I do agree. And it's something where, you know, I mean, this was her, was this her second? This is her second time at the Olympics, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. You know, and a lot of people don't want to, she's like now 24 and she was 19 at that time, 19
yeah,
roughly when she was first there. You know, I know for a fact when I was 19 compared to when I was 24, mentally, I was in a completely different place. Mm. When I was like 18 or 19, and if I was going to the Olympics, that's probably all that I cared about. That was my priority. That was the only thing that I cared about in the world at that point. I didn't have much else going on or probably to care about outside of that, you know?
Right.
But here I am now at 24, you know, I'm older. I've got more experience in life and just out in the real world. I've now been exposed to more. I'm probably more educated in matters, which means I probably have a deeper understanding of things, which means I probably feel things a bit deeper and whatnot. So experiencing things, and you know, I don't necessarily want to go into like details, but as you know, there's been a lot of stuff going on in her personal life, family and whatnot that, you know, has been talked about in the public. She's got a lot. She does have a lot on her shoulders and a lot that's going on. I cannot at all hold this against her, you know?
Right.
And someone like her, solely just because of the fact that she is already, she's a celebrity. You know, a lot of these athletes and gymnasts and stuff aren't. Simone is a celebrity. So yeah, naturally there is a bit more of like alignment and pedestal on her. But I don't think that's different or that's new to her. You know, I don't think that gave her an added pressure. She's used to that. That's normal to her. So because of that and her going through what that is, that's why I feel like people have so much more to say about it. Mm. And why it's such a big deal. But honestly, this sounds weird as it's coming out, but I'm glad that it was someone like her or someone with the platform that she does have that had to make this decision for herself, because now there's so many more people who are like watching and who are aware and who are, you know, probably now in more support or like understanding of these kinds of like issues that these young girls are constantly going through and battling.
Absolutely.
So that's my take on that.
Her aunt too passed away during the Olympics, right?
What?
Her aunt. Yeah, her aunt also passed away. Mm-hmm. So that was on top of all of this.
All the other stuff that she's going through.
Yeah. See?
I didn't know that at all, but I mean, that's just, let's add that to it. There were things that I wanted to note. So she's not the only athlete that's recently done this. We all know that Naomi Osaka also withdrew from the French Open and the Wimbledon. And of course, she did make it to the Olympics. So I'm sure she took that time to really just like practice and, you know, get in touch with herself so that she could show up to the Olympics. I'm sure if she hadn't, the Olympics wouldn't have been an option for her. And so I think that it's just awesome to see these women, these athletes be human.
Yes.
I think that we do a really terrible job at humanizing these people, and we put them on a pedestal and we think that they're like otherworldly and that they don't deal with the same issues that we deal with, but they fight so many. I feel like they're almost fighting more battles, because it's like, not only are they an athlete at the top of their, you know, industry or game or whatever they do, but it's like they also have the pressure of people who are mediocre at all the stuff that they do, and telling them like, you're not good enough, you're not being good enough. Like, they constantly have people just like bashing them, even though they are literally Olympians. She's an Olympian regardless of whether or not she won a medal for the team or actually competed. Let's not forget that she has 7 Olympic medals already, including 4 gold medals, 1 silver medal, and 2 bronze medals. And on top of that, she has in totality 32 medals, like world and Olympic medals.
Let them know.
I think she's okay to have a mental health day. Okay. Like, and I also keep bringing this up, but
All before the age of 24, by the way.
All before the age of 24. But let's also just not even forget the fact the year and a half that we have had. Like, let's please stop acting as if the world is still normal. We have the Delta variant coming at us stronger than, you know, regular COVID was. And in Tokyo alone, they're rising as the Olympics are happening. You guys remember, we were on here not too long ago talking about, were the Olympics even going to happen because the surge in cases in Tokyo? They're still surging, and they still had the Olympics. Olympians, a pole vaulter, tested positive for COVID right before he was going to do his final jump. They did like a very short time period quarantine for the rest of them, and then were like, let's get right back to it. You have got to be kidding me. That alone is enough to put me in a mental head spin, because I'm like, I'm supposed to compete, but also everybody's life is at stake. And we have everybody, the top athletes around the world. Everyone is there.
Thank you.
Besides spectators.
Ooh, Tay. And Tay, you just took us to church with that.
I'm just saying. Like,
no, I feel you.
You cannot.
And I feel like, but I think that is the biggest. That's the biggest elephant in the room, is that outside of the Simone Biles situation, is literally we're having the 2020 Olympics in 2021 because of a global pandemic. Like, literally everyone,
it's still going on.
Everybody was affected by this. Everyone
people died. People weren't able to see their families. Like, we've not had any real social interaction. You're like, hey, go back to the Olympics.
I'm sure there was people who were supposed to be at the Olympics who probably passed because of COVID.
You know,
or how many people who are at the Olympics who have had loved ones pass because
of COVID?
That's
what I'm saying.
There's not even, there's a list of things that could be attributed to the state of the mental health of any one of these persons.
I would not be surprised if every single one of them's not battling some kind of mental health issue, regardless if it's COVID or just like the pressure to compete, or it's just, there's a lot going on. I mean, and then Simone Biles, she's got all the other stuff that we know about that she's got going on. It's just like, give the girl a break. She's human. She can only take so much. And then I just want to bring up one last thing, because I saw this on Facebook and I just kind of thought it was disgusting and also like a terrible comparison. But when people were criticizing her, they often compared her to Carrie Strug. Now, if you guys know who Carrie Strug was, she was also on the USA Olympic team back in 1996. She was 18 years old, and she was the woman who on her first vault sprained her ankle, injured her ankle. And then they made her go for her second vault on her injured ankle. Now, she landed the vault, got the points, but Carrie Strug never came back. She was absolutely done after that. That is a testament to us prioritizing gold medals, money, and notoriety over human bodies. And Carrie Strug actually commended Simone for putting her mental health and herself over the gold medal and over winning. And I think that this is just like a lesson to be learned, because it's like, I'm sorry, if I'm hurt or injured or whatever, what is a win like really gonna do? Like, I know, even as an athlete myself, I pushed myself through a hamstring injury. And if you guys know anything about track, hamstrings injuries are A, not good, hard to come back from, and hard to compete on. I was not at my best. I could not have been at my best. And so it was just like, why am I out here? Because we needed the points. But it's like, why put yourself through that? Take the time to heal and come back better. It doesn't make sense.
Like, dude, like, who gets money if you win a medal? Who's the people that get the money if you get a medal?
So it's really more just like a, let's think of it as like a machine. All of these athletes have sponsors.
Endorsement deals, understood. All these other things.
You know what I'm saying?
It's
so if
vision.
She pulls out, then they're like, oh, well, then our stuff wasn't. It's more of like an all-around thing. I'm not sure how the Olympics work.
But when I think about it,
it's like team scoring. You drop out, now your team's lost those points. They need the points in order to win. I don't know on the Olympic level what it means to win gold as like the USA team, but I'm sure it means something. Or else they wouldn't be pushing them so hard to, you know, work through injuries, push through injuries. You know what I'm saying? So it's really just that. I mean, at the end of the day, who knows if there's even money being made when you win a gold for the team.
Right.
Like, they're probably, you know, just it's, want the gold so that we are best. And
I think I think about it like, you know, the whole NCAA thing, like how they just made it so that, you know, athletes can start profiting off of their namesake and whatnot. Yeah. And that's kind of what I think about. Like you, when you say it's the machine, it's like, so not even really probably directly affecting the person who's doing the hard work.
Yeah.
And literally putting themselves through all of this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like, their,
I love that for them.
Their bodies. You know what
I'm
saying?
I just love that.
Yeah, it's awesome. You know what? Go you, Simone Biles, and anybody else who wants to come forward and just be like a trailblazer for the mental health, at, like, you know, cause. Like,
hey, and you know what? I'm really here for it. And what I really appreciate too is that these are women of color, and we all know that mental health amongst, you know, the community of persons of color, especially the Black community, African American community, it's not really there. The conversation's not really there. So hopefully this just continues to build that momentum with, it is okay. It's okay to not be okay. And you young Black man, it's all right. Get some help. And there's nothing wrong with that.
There's literally nothing wrong with it.
On a similar note related to mental health, you guys, following, we just recently had the 6 month mark of the January 6th insurrection attempt on the Capitol. That happened earlier this year. And two more officers, I just read yesterday, two more officers have died by apparent suicide following that those attacks. So in an article that I found on CBS News, Officer Gunther Hashida and Kyle DeFreitag, both long-term vets of the police force, were both found deceased last month in their homes. These were actually two separate instances and occasions. One happened, I believe, earlier in the month, I believe on like the 3rd or 4th of July, and the other one more towards like the middle. And these two officers passing marks actually four total deaths by suicide since that day. Brian Sicknick and Howard Labengood, who were both veterans of the force, I'm talking 12-year and 15-year vets of the force, they passed away by suicide in the days immediately following the attack. And I'm sure that you guys also have heard the trials and all of that have recently been going on and started. You know, Tay, I'll get your take and input in just a second, but A lot of what I've been reading in that same article, many people's accounts, even from the trial, as they're kind of recollecting what happened, a lot of people are relating it to what would be a medieval battle, or just like, you know, imagine kind of like when I hear medieval, I think of like Game of Thrones and just like, you know, just madness, you know.
I mean, they had a guillotine, but like a noose. I don't know where they do that at anymore.
Yeah, and just, you know, it's, a lot of people said it was something they've never seen before, one of the worst experiences of their lives, and it clearly has taken a toll on people who were involved and those who were there to defend. All of these people were there to defend and protect our lawmakers, and look at the toll that it's taken. And just, and then I'm sure you know, following all of the sources and all the people who incited this, those who have incited this have only just continued to like poke the fire and poke the bear. And just, I'm sure those who are, I don't know, because I'm not involved in that world. I'm so sorry to those who are. It's sad, it's dark, it's deep, but they're not kind. And I'm sure they're probably maybe egging these people on, or like, not, I don't know how to explain it. I'm sure these people are probably coming under attack.
I was going to say that.
Or, you know, yeah.
I was going to say that. So that was something that I wanted to kind of point out, was that like the most recent suicide happened and they've started the trial. So like some of these officers have testified, and even one of the officers that testified, they're receiving death threats from people who are part of the insurrection. And like, they're calling them awful things. They're leaving voicemails, just basically calling them out of their name for absolutely no, for doing their job at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Like, you know, if you guys remember not so long ago, you know, when Trump was president, their entire like campaign was to, you know, like they were trying to keep law and order, you know, they were for the police. But here you are now and you're sending death threats and calling them the F word and the P word and just like being horrible to these people that did their job on this day because you didn't get your way. And I think that it's telling. And I think that anybody who can seriously sit here and still think that A, that Trump didn't incite this, and B, that nothing went wrong and had nothing to do with Trump and what he had to say, you're in denial. And you need to wake up. Like,
I mean, the effects are still right here happening, you know, and unfolding in front of us. Yeah,
exactly. I mean, if nothing, it's just like, I think that seeing what's happening to these officers, and if you're actually watching the trial, which I haven't, because to be honest, like, I'm very pessimistic about the outcome.
Yeah.
I do not think they're going to do what they're supposed to do. And I think that if they don't, that our way of living, like democracy, is going to be a threat. And I don't want to watch it because I don't want to be upset about it. But I just think that anybody, like, there's so many people that still feel like, oh, it was just a extremist group. That wasn't real. Trump didn't do that. But Trump is still sitting here saying that it was a stolen election.
It was rigged. And
they still
won,
have Republicans that are still trying to hold everything up as if that's what happened. I mean, come on, guys.
Yeah. And it's no joke. Like, you know, people's lives are at stake still, and people are being affected by this daily. And you know, we do need to hop into another quick break here. Tay, I'm going to let you outro to that, but before we do that, and to wrap up our combo on mental health, if you or someone you know or love, you know, needs help, or you know, if they feel like they're struggling or they're in a dark place, you know, you can always get help. There's always someone there for you, and you can always call. We have the suicide hotline number here. It's 1-800-273-8255. Take us out.
Yes. Let us know what you guys think about both of those hot topics. What do you think about Simone Biles' withdrawal and about the current insurrection trial that's going on? Stay tuned. You guys are listening to The Way with Jazz and Tay.